Dong Zhuo is remembered as the Tyrant of the Romance of the Three Kingdoms, but much like Thanos in Infinity War, he may have had a point. So let's take a new look at Dong Zhuo and try and find the method behind the madness. This video was inspired by a post I found on an old Three Kingdoms forum by the username Morg, in which he defends Dong Zhuo, and I couldn't help but feel maybe he had a few points. He starts with a simple enough argument. Dong Zhuo was one of the most straightforward people of the era. He had no hidden agendas. He simply did what he wanted to and made no excuses for it. It's the same reason characters like Ragnar and Ivar and Vikings are so loved even today, but for some reason Dong Zhuo gets a bad rap. When Dong Zhuo first appears on the scene, he's actually ordered to go to the capital to end the strife caused there by the eunuchs, and if you're not aware, basically all of the downfall of the Han Empire can be blamed on the eunuchs. And that's exactly what he did. He restored stability and corrected the wrongs done by the 10 regular attendants. He even made sure to give some people back their positions. Now, sure, you can argue this was just to win the support of the people, but it still gives him merit. Later on, he goes to depose the emperor, but this same emperor wasn't even the true emperor, you could argue. The late emperor had named a completely different person to claim the throne, and Yuan Shao had put a pretender on the throne. If anything, Dong Zhuo was righting another wrong. The problem is the way he goes about things. It's too abrupt for a courtly society, and his biographers cut him no slack, citing that he flaunted the laws of heaven and earth. One of his first big grievances was ordering his guards to carry arms while he was at the palace, which made sense as they're in the middle of a civil war and under a constant threat of attack. And later on, Dong Zhuo took to wearing armor all the time, but this was only after a failed assassination attempt. But these displays of power just magnified as his rule went on. He took the royal concubines for himself, which is a supreme no-no. But as the emperor was only 9 years old, it's not exactly like he was using them. And a lot of these small, gruff infractions can be put down to Duong Zhuo's upbringing on the distant frontier. He wasn't a court man. These same gruff personality traits that had made him such an effective general and suppressor of rebellions ruffled the sensitive sensibilities of the eunuchs. Now, to be fair to historians, slaughtering people at a dinner table is a war crime. Dong Zhuo made it very clear what happened to anyone that was caught alive after a battle, sometimes wrapping them in fat-soaked clothing and lighting them on fire, and in one account, actually held a giant feast and had people tortured during the feast, cutting out their tongues and then boiling them alive and then making a giant fat meatball out of them, which was left on display for everyone to look at. Now, if this seems a little bit excessive to you, it's because it probably was. Everything about it just rings of falsities, not unlike how Vlad the Impaler later on became the blood-sucking monster Dracula. But from Dong Zhuo's perspective, he's in the middle of not only a civil war, but a civil uprising, and needed to use every item at his disposal to reassert the power of the Han Empire. These gross power displays were an effective way of ensuring that resistance was minimal and preventing further bloodshed. It's the classic argument, would you kill one to save 100? But instead, it's would you torture one to prevent a war that would kill millions? But the big one that people remember about Dong Zhuo is that he moved the capital from Laoyang, opening up all the ancestral tombs, robbing them, and then burning it to the ground. He wasn't about to leave valuable resources for his enemies. Taken from another perspective, it almost sounds like Dong Zhuo was employing a scorched earth policy to make sure that his enemies pursuing him didn't have anything to use in his wake. But Laoyang wasn't exactly a defensible position. It was completely surrounded by the coalition, and it actually makes sense from a strategic viewpoint to relocate it to the more defensible mountains of the west of China. As he was already having to evacuate, he couldn't exactly leave it in the hands of the oncoming coalition, as their taking of the capital also gives their revolt a sense of authenticity and authority that he couldn't allow. And by leaving such a strong deterrent in his wake, the entire coalition fell apart, squabbling with what to do next. The account of him rounding up all the people and then marching them onto the next city also seems somewhat biased, as Liu Bei actually marches a city full of people of Changban, and it's not told in an entirely different light. And it just feels like anything that happened at the time was just thrown at Dong Zhuo's feet. Modern depictions show him as a fat and lecherous old man. But in his youth, he was a paragon of chivalry. In many ways, he reminds me of Henry VIII. Sure, in his later years, he was prone to debauchery and all sorts of horribleness, but he was still an effective ruler in his own way. I'm not saying Dong Zhuo didn't have other options and couldn't have taken a more peaceful path, but at the time, a man who had been trained to war to bring savagery to his land used those same skills to hold together a crumbling government. Extreme situations require extreme tactics. Abraham Lincoln allowed William Tecumseh Sherman to burn everything from Atlanta to Savannah, but it doesn't exactly taint his memory today. You can't help but wonder if Dong Zhuo had won the war, what we would think about him now. So the next time you think about Dong Zhuo, maybe think about Thanos, and maybe Dong Zhuo had something of a point. But I'm really curious what you guys think. Make sure to leave your comments below on this little theory of mine.